Hello and welcome to another Facebook Live from the PBS NewsHour. My name is Hari Srinivasan. This is Sam Lester from the EPIC, which is Electronic Privacy Information Center. I thankfully got that right. It's the first beautiful day of spring in Washington, D.C. There's snow falling outside. There's schools are all out. So perhaps you are sitting on Facebook right now thinking to yourself, there's been so much news about Facebook and privacy settings and apps, et cetera. Maybe I should take a look at my own privacy settings. So this Facebook Live is going to try to do three things. I'm a little list here. One, we're going to try to show you what Facebook already knows about you. And this is actually pretty easy for you to get to, but a lot of people don't bother looking at that. Okay. Two, we're going to show you what Facebook says you can do about your own privacy settings and how they've structured their page so that you can go tweak all the settings you want. And then three, we're going to have a little bit bigger picture conversation about whether or how any of this matters and how this all plays in, and Sam is going to help us do that. So, first of all, we should remind you that we are doing this on Facebook. This is about Facebook on Facebook. This is actually the perfect audience. You should know how to change your own settings if you want to. But in the meantime, if you have questions, please leave them in the comments section. We'll try to get to those and some of those in a few minutes. And a portion of this might appear on a broadcast. So please keep it nice, short, sweet. And then the other part that we wanted to say was we will try to get to these questions. It'll be about 15, 20 minutes into this conversation. I'm watching a bunch of different little screens at the same time. You can also use Twitter if that is what's in your hand right now. You can use the hashtag AskNewsHour. You can tweet at me, at Hari. You can tweet at Epic Privacy. Sam might check that. Sam might not. But anyway, there's plenty of ways to interact with us, so please take advantage of it. That's what this is here for. So I'm going to try to show you what Facebook knows about me by going into my own Facebook page. This is fraught with potential terror. I do not want to expose my personal information to all of you, even though I love you. I don't necessarily know all of you, so, or really any of you. So let's start with this. First things first.
Can I go to your page?
No, don't go to my page yet. So in the upper right-hand corner, okay, you can look at my page just for a second. In the upper right-hand corner over here, you can see, go ahead, take the page. All right, there's this big drop-down menu for the little arrow. If you click on the arrow, and if you go down to settings, all right, don't look at my page for a second. Take it away. Okay.
Hold on.
Yep. Okay, so if you go into the settings page, on the left-hand side, you're going to have to trust me, on the left-hand side, there's a word called ads. It's on kind of the lower section under apps, and you just click on ads. Clicking, waiting, loading. You can take the page.
Okay.
All right, so this is the section that says your ad preferences. Now, under this, you'll see your interests, advertisers you've interacted with, your information, ad settings. Kudos that it's actually accessible. Most of you might not have known that this exists, but let's just click example for interests. Now, this is what Facebook thinks that I am interested in, or it thinks that it knows that I'm interested in. And this is part of how I am packaged and sold to advertisers. So for example, an advertiser wants to reach somebody who might be interested in, I guess, Airbnb, Netflix, Lyft, LifeLock, mattress. Didn't know I was in the mood for a mattress, but woodworking. I'm actually not that interested in woodworking. I am interested in bed and sleeping. Dentistry, I haven't been to the dentist enough, but perhaps that makes me a great candidate for more ads from dentists. Open table, et cetera. But you can also see in this section, this is business and industry. You've got news and entertainment. Oh, this is going to be interesting. Oh, good. I like the PBS NewsHour. That's always good to know. Video games? Not so much. Washington Post, Outlook Magazine. I don't really know. Elizabeth the Film. Never seen it. Not interested in it. It is not my source of entertainment. SPG points. Okay. Cairo TV. That's one of the places that I interned in Seattle. So some things it's kind of amazing that it knows, and some things it's pretty wrong on. Okay. Hobbies and activities. Winemaking, that's a lie. I don't drink, and I don't go out and make wine. New Year's Day, I guess maybe I'm interested in New Year's Day. I am not a twin. Let's see, technology, home advisor, Uber, headphones, Facebook, that's true. So, Buffer, okay, these are apps. People that I'm interested in, Zac Efron, definitely not interested. It's interesting, okay, clothing, shopping, fashion. So, again, this is technically speaking, these are indications that you have given to Facebook in some way, whether you liked or interacted with a page. Okay, advertisers you've interacted with, that's the second section. I've never been to a Vons, I don't think, at least not in years. Safeway, when I used to live in Seattle or the West Coast, sure. Tom Thumb, I don't know what that is really. Tabletop games. Again, some of these make sense to me, some of them do not. Whose website or app have you used? That's really strange. I didn't know that I've ever used the app What India Eats or Golf Digest. Okay, whom I visited. All right, so your information, I'm going to leave that alone because I don't want you to see my personal information. So that's technically one section. And again, all you had to do was you had to just drop down this arrow, click on the settings page that's right here, and then on the left-hand side, click on ads. All right? So then the second section we want to talk about a little bit is what Facebook has done over the years. They have been accused of privacy violations and in both legal terms and in kind of societal terms for a long time. And they have said, listen, we've taken lots of steps to try to make it easy for you if you want to sit at home on a snowy day and change your privacy settings. So how to do that? Pretty easy. Right under the big question mark sign in the upper right-hand corner of your Facebook page, there's two sections that I see anyway, and I don't know if you see the same thing, but one is privacy checkup and another one is privacy shortcuts. Let's go through both of those really quickly. Privacy checkup. It posts. Whenever you post from newsfeed on your profile, you can choose an audience to control who sees it. All right, so this is the kind of stuff if perhaps you don't want your family members or you don't want your boss, et cetera, you can say, I only want my friends to see it. Friends, accept these people. I only want to post to myself, okay, if that's something you want to do. Apps. This is kind of interesting in the context of, all right, let me press next. In the context of what happened with Cambridge Analytica, back in those days, Cambridge Analytica was actually, they bought data that was from a different app. What was the name of that app again?
This is
Your Digital Life, right? Yeah. So there was a researcher that put out an app called This Is Your Digital Life. People downloaded it, shared all this information, and then that information is what got its way into Cambridge Analytica. And of course, the allegation is that it also went into the Trump campaign, right? So these are apps apparently that I've interacted with. Or what's interesting is I am not a Facebook developer, but I guess that's just Flickster? That is a movie finding app. I don't think that I've ever interacted with All Trails. That's for hiking trails. Vimeo, Lumosity, the brain games thing. Let's just delete that app. I don't really know why I have that on there, but let's see. Yelp, Scribd, Quora, Points.com, Runtastic. Huh. Endomondo. These are a bunch of athlete apps. I'm not really as much of an athlete as my app list makes me out to be. Snappy TV, NPR login, Instagram. Wow. I had no idea there were that many apps. Social Flow, House. Jeez, what are some of these? Munchery. Okay. Clearly, there have been a lot of apps on my machine, but I could learn more. I could delete them. I could change the settings. So that is under the privacy checkup banner, right? So again, we're just going to go backwards right to the question mark, the help section on the upper right-hand corner. And then there's this thing called privacy shortcuts. We just did the privacy checkup. And this is in relatively simple, plain English. Who can see my stuff? You can change that. You can say it's going to be public. Who can contact me? Friends of friends can contact me. Friends can help. How do I stop someone from bothering me? It looks like you can create a blacklist, and you can view all the blocked users. So that's just two sections right from the main page, the help center on the upper right-hand corner, the privacy checkup, and the privacy shortcuts. All right, so we've gone through this. We've done the first two parts. We've shown you what Facebook knows or roughly about you, or at least how they sell you as a product to different advertisers and people who want to reach you, and two, how Facebook says that you can change your settings. Now comes part three. Part three is Sam Lester from the Electronic Privacy Information Center, EPIC, EPIC for short. He's going to kind of walk us through a couple of things here. I'm going to switch screens, and he can drive for a little bit, but... Okay, so I just did all these settings. I'm safe now, right?
Okay, so to throw a little cold water on all of that, I want to start out with a challenge for everyone who's watching this. I'm assuming you're watching this on Facebook. If you are watching it on Facebook, I want to give you a little challenge, and maybe we can give them just a little bit of time to do this.
Yeah.
So you may or may not know that Facebook tracks you when you visit third-party websites. When you browse the web, Facebook's tracking you. See if you can
outside of Facebook, right? So when I'm just not on Facebook, but
when you're not on Facebook,
wild internet,
they're tracking you. Even when you're logged out of Facebook, there's a case now that they call the Hotel California case because you can log out anytime you like, but you can never leave. So even if you're logged out of Facebook, Facebook's still tracking you.
Okay.
So I want the users who are watching at home on Facebook give them a little challenge. See if you can find where Facebook discloses that.
Facebook discloses. All right, so my guess, I'm going to switch back to my own screen here. My guess is terms of service. And terms of service is usually at the bottom of the page. I'm going to click terms. Statement of rights and responsibilities. This is usually the stuff that I press I submit or I agree to. This is the fine print. And in the interests of making it readable for me, because this is really small and I'm getting old.
Can you go through that process one more time?
Yeah, I'll go through that process one more time. Let's go back. Okay, this was, let's go back again. So this was basically at the bottom of your Facebook page.
Are you cool with me showing the screen?
Yeah. The bottom of the Facebook page, there's the top of the Facebook page, scroll to the bottom of any page, there's a little word called terms, and I clicked on terms, and it showed up with this Facebook terms and policies. Again, this is the broken down version of that thing that you said, I agree, and I submit, and I comply. The statement of rights and responsibilities, that is usually the fine print.
So this is where you think you're going to find
that's
Facebook
where I think
saying
I'm gonna find
that it's
it.
Going to track you on third-party websites.
Yeah, that seems like this would be the place where they would say it. I have six pages printed out. Disputes, termination amendments. No, not mobile and other. No, that's
you would
not
think.
Really.
So no. You could read that whole thing, and actually it doesn't say that in the statement of rights and responsibilities.
Okay, all right, let's go back a section.
So
all right,
you would have spent maybe a good part of your afternoon reading that.
Okay.
And you still wouldn't find it.
So section 2, data policy, information
okay.
we receive
a
and
little,
how it's used.
A little warmer.
Okay, we have sections here. What kinds of information do we collect? How do we use this information? How is this information? All right, this all seems like plain English questions. And what was the question? What was our challenge again?
Oh, well,
the Hotel California challenge?
The Hotel California challenge was to find where it tells you that they're going to track you on third-party websites.
Communicate with you shows them. Okay, not there. apps, websites, third-party integration, maybe.
Maybe.
When you use third-party apps, websites, or other services that user. Oh, my God. How am I supposed to understand this? Public profile, which. So this is like in the middle of the section that's in the middle of the section that is underneath the fine print section, which is at the bottom of the page. Okay. All right.
Okay.
Well, that's where it is.
So there you go. So maybe there's some information there. What's so just absurd about all of this is Facebook says, and there's a number of lawsuits against Facebook right now, and when people bring these lawsuits, Facebook says, oh, you've consented to all of this.
Yeah.
We have it all laid out in our terms of service and our statements of rights and responsibilities. Even if anybody did read those, which...
Like, a lot of people don't.
I think
most
nobody
people don't.
Does.
Right.
Even if you did read all of those, try figuring out exactly what's going on.
Okay, you know, one of the things that came up yesterday is, and really in Ron Wyden's letter to Facebook, as well as a conversation yesterday we had, is that the Federal Trade Commission is now probing into this because
right.
of something called a consent decree, essentially, that they had on Facebook a few years ago. And this was based on some bad behavior by Facebook, and the Federal Trade Commission says,
right.
no, here are things, and you've pulled this up.
Exactly. So suppose you did read all of their privacy policies, right? And suppose you did understand them completely. You've got some tech savvy. You know exactly what Facebook's doing, exactly what information they're accessing, and exactly, like you showed, exactly how you can control your privacy policies. You're good, right?
Yeah.
You know what Facebook's doing. You're protecting your privacy. Actually, you're not. Let's just go through a little bit of this list of the things that they did that got them under an FTC order.
Okay.
So they represented that when you posted certain information, it was only available to your friends, right?
Yeah.
It wasn't.
The section we're
talking about. It was made public. Exactly. This is the section. They represented that third-party apps that you installed would only have access to the information they needed to operate.
That didn't happen.
Wrong. They
right.
were accessing all your information. Facebook also told users that they could restrict their sharing to just limited audiences, friends only. In fact... They didn't. It was being shared with all third-party apps. And this is actually one of the most important points, and maybe if you read this, you would gloss over this one, where Facebook said that it had a verified apps program and it claimed that it knew the security and
mm-hmm.
privacy of all the apps that were collecting data from it. This is where Cambridge Analytica comes in, because, as you may know, Cambridge Analytica did not get the data directly from Facebook, right? People downloaded this third-party app, this is your digital life, third-party app had access to, not to get too technical, but they had access to what's called the Social Graph API, which back in 2014, it might not be the case now, but back then, that app could have access not only to everything that was on your profile. So 270,000 people roughly downloaded the app. Not only had access to all those people's profiles, it had access to everything that was on all of their friends' profiles. And that's how
you get
Cambridge was able to get the data on 50 million or 30
million,
however,
yeah.
Whatever the number is. So nobody who had ever interacted with the app, This Is Your Digital Life, nobody had ever heard of it, somehow that app now has all of their profile data.
So if any friend of mine was part of that 270,000 person group that downloaded the app, what was on my page is also accessible.
Right.
To that app.
Right.
And then by, in turn, to Cambridge Analytica or whoever
exactly.
might have purchased it.
So okay. Facebook now, they're throwing up their hands. They're saying, Cambridge lied to us. We didn't know that they had all this app. Well, under the FTC consent order, it was their job to know what these apps were doing.
So,
it was their job to check up on these apps.
So what can the FTC do? When they levy a fine, is it by infraction? Is it by company? Is it by year? What does it do?
So when a company is under consent order, they can theoretically be on the hook for $40,000 per violation. So if you multiply that by 50 million users who had their data stolen...
That's a very big number.
That's
40,000 times
$2 trillion.
$2 trillion. That's a little bit more than the stock is valued. I'm exaggerating. It's a lot more. It's a ton of money, which obviously very few companies ever get prosecuted to that extent and are fined that much. But, for example, Google has been fined before, and it's
right.
been fined both here and across the pond in the EU.
Exactly. And the EU has a lot stricter rules, and they have the ability to levy much higher fines. Google was fined by the FTC a few years ago. For violating a consent order, and I think it was about $22.5 million, which is the largest fine that the FTC has ever levied. And for companies like Google and Facebook, that's change that they find in the couch cushions. So
this one, next one.
So let's take a look at this next screen. So you showed us Facebook's privacy settings for the user when you go into Facebook, and I want to show you a little bit of what the advertiser sees on the other end, right?
Okay.
So suppose you create an app and you want people to download this app and you want to advertise on Facebook. This is an infographic that explains everything that the developer would see about how to target people.
People traveling in this location, people recently in this location, or everyone that's there. You can sort by age, you can sort by gender, if their relationship status, their sexual preference or relationship preference. What languages they speak, what level of education.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
So go back up to the top. So I can use these demographics to narrow this down so that I'm targeting you specifically.
Right.
So each one seems pretty broad, right?
Yeah.
Gender, but I can start with location. So I can narrow the location down to...
Wisconsin or
yeah,
Michigan.
Yeah. Zip code, postal code, and I think even more accurate than that. Then I can target it by the school you went to. So I can narrow it down to a location like this block. Then I can put in the school that you went to. I can put in your field of study.
So this is really like I put in what high school I went to on Facebook. Now they have that as a data point.
Exactly. So is any of this identifiable back to me? Well, let's go to the very bottom. Because a lot of people think, okay, advertisers have all of this information, but they don't know like who it is. They're just seeing like random data points.
Right.
Well, not really. They can customize and search this information based on your email address, based on your phone number, and even based on your Facebook user ID. So it is personally identifiable when advertisers have access to this information. Now,
what if I'm not on Facebook? How does Facebook have any way to target me or sell ads to me if I'm not a member?
Now, that's a good point. Facebook actually is collecting your data and tracking you, even if you've never set up a Facebook account.
How's that?
So, you know how when you go to websites, you see like that little Facebook thumbs up symbol?
Sure. To like a page or
yeah.
to like an article, et
cetera. So, very many websites, maybe even
yeah,
your website, maybe
ours.
Even PBS has what's called a Facebook social plugin. It's like a little snippet of code that the website installs that allows a user who visits the website to like the page, to share the page with their friends on Facebook. And when that little social plugin is on a page, it means that Facebook is tracking every user based on their browser's unique ID so that they know who's visiting that page and that they can collect that information and build a profile on you. And they're building a profile on you even if you're not a Facebook user. So that if you ever decide to join Facebook, then they've got all your information and they know what ads to target you with.
Because then, for example, they would know that I like to go to the PBS NewsHour site already.
Exactly.
And that factors into exactly. a lot of the other data points.
So just to say, I'm going to protect my privacy by never even joining Facebook. Unfortunately, that doesn't even work because Facebook's still tracking you even if you've never joined.
So Becky Youngman just asked, how do I prevent Facebook from tracking me when I'm not on Facebook?
Call your congressman.
Becky, call your congressman. I don't know where you live. I haven't looked at your profile. But Tiffany Eileen asked, someone mentioned deleting your current account and starting over. What good would that do?
So let's go back to this consent order, because what if people deleted their accounts? So Facebook claimed that when users deactivated or deleted their accounts, their photos and videos would be inaccessible.
But Facebook allowed access to the content even after users had deactivated. This is what happened to get them in hot water. Have they changed since then?
Apparently not. Right. And this kind of
brings
us to...
Because technically this information was still accessible years
right.
after the breach.
So this kind of brings us to the main point, which is, so, like, what do we do about all this? And the FTC, it's their job. When a company enters into a consent order, they have a legal obligation not to do these things, right? And the only way... to be prevented from doing those things is for the FTC to investigate them. And actually, under the terms of the order, the FTC is required to investigate them, and they're required to submit regular reports to the FTC on their privacy policies. And we believe that those reports should be public. We believe that the public should be able to actually see and evaluate for themselves, is Facebook complying with the law? And it's interesting that at least I find it interesting that, you know, everyone's talking about these issues now, because our organization, of course, we've been calling attention to these issues for over a decade. We right. actually brought the original complaint to the FTC that resulted in that consent order. And this stuff was going on political campaigns for years, and it's bipartisan. I mean, Obama's team was doing this. Hillary Clinton's team was doing this. All campaigns were collecting this data. Back in 2012, one of the Obama campaign spokesperson was bragging about how they were getting people to download an app, just what Cambridge Analytica did, and they were mm-hmm. scraping the profiles. So this is not just a Cambridge Analytica issue. This is not just a Trump campaign issue. This is an everybody issue. This affects all companies, all apps had access to this information, and it's encouraging that now people are looking at this and it's getting some attention. And I also want to talk just briefly about the political side of this and political ads on Facebook, because mm-hmm. One of the real concerns that people had after this election was how potentially Russia or just anyone could use Facebook to target certain demographics and target certain people with fake news or just incendiary material, or things that would, you know, really shift public sentiment and manipulate voters.
Yeah.
So one of the issues that we've been calling for a long time is algorithmic transparency. You know, Facebook has all these algorithms that
sure.
determine who gets targeted and why they're getting targeted with certain information. We believe that at least for political ads, and we've actually been calling on the Federal Election Commission to do this, and they're starting to potentially institute some regulations, but we believe that the algorithms that Facebook uses to determine how voters are targeted, that should be public information, that voters have a right to know why they're being targeted with an ad, and, you know, why... It's not just enough to know,
yep.
you know, who's funding the ad, which we already have a right to know, right? When
right.
we see an ad on TV, we know who paid for the ad. We should also know in the context of Facebook, why am I seeing this ad? Why are they targeting me?
You know, if you're just joining us, we are talking with Sam Lester of the Electronic Privacy Information Center. We've been talking about, in the first part of this chat, we talked about Facebook and what it already knows about you and how to get to your settings. So if you want to go back in that part of the video, you can check. And then also we took a look at the settings that you have some control over. And then Sam has been throwing cold water on that entire enterprise here. We're also taking your questions, so you can leave them in the comments section. We've got people monitoring, and you can also ask via Twitter or anywhere else. But with the hashtag AskNewsHour, Betsy Hauser asks, if I delete my Facebook, is my data still good? What happens to the data? That is one of the questions that we just kind of addressed, that the consent decree, this was the Federal Trade Commission years ago, said this has been a problem in the past. And then as we now know that the data from that app that went to Cambridge Analytica wasn't deleted, and so technically that data still existed. Trish Becker asked, does this apply to me even if I've never downloaded a third-party app?
So did you download This Is Your Digital Life?
Right. If you're not one of those people, then that's fine. But as I went through in your settings page, if you go to the upper right-hand corner, click the little arrow, drop down to settings, and then on the very left-hand side, click ads, I think, you can see all of the stuff that Facebook knows about you. And then under the privacy shortcuts, you can also see sections based on apps where you can actually go and see all of the apps that you've actually enabled and turned on and who they're visible to and what you're sharing. So that's one of the things, Trish, that you should be aware of, is that even I was finding apps that I didn't ever know that I'd downloaded, but they were in there and somehow they were integrated into Facebook. Marina McLean, are you saying they use everyone's data collected for advertising purposes? How does it benefit Facebook? Pretty simple question. How does it benefit Facebook?
Well, if you're an advertiser, you want to know that your ads are going to the right people.
Right.
And Facebook is pretty has a pretty dominant market position in terms of people's information. The whole enterprise of targeted advertising is, you know, what people say, well, this is why the internet is free. And, of course, you know, A lot of these things have brought a lot of advantages to our life, but you know, we think there still needs to be some sensible and reasonable accountability for how our data is used. I mean, that's all we're saying, you know.
Renee Bartovics asks, again, if you like this conversation, share it on your own Facebook page, and hopefully there will be some information in there that you find valuable. Renee Bartovics, what about private chats on Messenger? Is this also mined? Messenger is something that people use sort of inside and outside Facebook. I have a Messenger window open
and
I'll close it.
So that's actually an issue. Facebook has, at certain points in time, and they may be doing this now, intercepting your private chats and using that for advertising purposes. There have been lawsuits about this.
The concern was, for example, that Google was reading my email. Not that there's actually a human being sitting here reading in the email between you and I, but that there basically are machines saying, the word bicycles seems to come up with between these two guys. Maybe we can show him a relevant ad for bicycles.
How do you know that a human being's not reading the email?
I don't, but I'm just saying, I think it would be just, it would take too many humans to read all of the emails that are being generated by Gmail.
They're not going to read all of them, but they could read some of them.
Right.
The FBI could read some of them. These are not hypotheticals, right? You know, when a company is collecting your data, they can hand that over to law enforcement. In fact, in many instances, they have to hand that over to law enforcement.
Right. Companies are going to say, listen, this algorithmic transparency that you're asking for, that's the secret sauce of our business, right? So you can't tell Heinz to give away the recipe to the 57 sauce. That's just like asking us to tell you what's in the algorithm.
We're not asking anyone to give away their secret sauce. We're just asking for a measure of accountability, right? If Heinz was putting some sort of poisonous chemical in their ketchup, right, we'd want to know about that. In fact, Heinz has to disclose what's in their ketchup, right? They don't have to disclose their secret sauce, but at least there's a list of ingredients on the back of the bottle. So that's all we're asking for. We're asking for just reasonable accountability so that people know how a political campaign is targeting voters.
You know, the other thing, I'm going to move your mic up here because it looks like it slid down. But
sorry.
The other thing people are going to ask is, or people are going to say is, listen, this is a free country. You can opt in to Facebook. You can certainly opt out. You don't have to be a part of this piece of software. You don't have to participate in this digital economy.
Well, that kind of goes to the whole point of, you know, Facebook is sort of the digital town square, sort of the marketplace of ideas, right? And there shouldn't have to be this trade-off for us to to go and spread our ideas and, you know, engage in our First Amendment expression on Facebook, that we have to trade off all of our privacy, right? You know, it's not an either-or situation. You know, as a society, we can have reasonable regulations. We can have reasonable accountability and oversight. You know, and the other thing is Facebook's a monopoly, right? You know, they have market dominance. And, you know, we could talk about whether that's a good thing and, you know, maybe our antitrust laws need to be more robustly enforced. But at the very least, we need some digital accountability for a place like Facebook that, you know, I'm pro-Facebook. You know, I love reading people's news feeds and interacting with people and seeing what people are sharing on Facebook.
All right. Sam Lester from the Electronic Privacy Information Center, thanks so much for your time.
Thank you.
And thank you on Facebook Live for all of your comments and questions. Again, if you like this video, you can share it on your Facebook feed. And again, go back and check the sections that we highlighted in the beginning of the video, where it allows you to see what Facebook already knows about you and your profile and what you can do about it. My name is Hari Srinivasan. Thanks for joining us on Facebook Live and the PBS NewsHour.